Jesus, may we ever be grafted, rooted, built in thee. So ends the second and final verse of the sacramental Eucharistic hymn, Bread of Heaven, on thee we feed. Jesus, may we ever be grafted, rooted, built in thee. Grafting is a tricky process. It's known, obviously, in the medical world through the process of skin grafting, something that has to be undertaken with great skill, with great care, to avoid any kind of problem such as infection or whatever. But I suppose many of us may be slightly more familiar with the process of grafting in terms of horticulture. In terms of skin grafting, well, it enables something to be healed. In terms of horticulture, though, it's a means of producing a better, more sturdy crop, producing something that will be perhaps more nourishing and better fruiting. The grafting is not only skilled work, but if you put it into the slightly more modern context of describing someone as a grafter, then it's also recognized as not only skilled work, but hard work. Someone who is a grafter does what they do, achieves what they can through skill, but also through sheer determination in order to achieve the end result. This morning we heard a passage sung by the choir from Psalm 22. Psalm 22 is a psalm more usually associated with the Passion story. The first longer section of it is usually sung at the liturgy on Good Friday. And that portion of it is a portion that speaks of abject misery, of someone whose life has been broken, someone in the depths of sorrow. Let me quote some of the phrases from that early part of the psalm. They pierce my hands and my feet. You'll see the connection immediately with the Passion story. They part my garments among them. Another echo. But today's section brings about a complete change of mood. Let me just read the opening verse. My praise is on thee in the great congregation. My vows I will perform in the sight of them that fear. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and they that seek the Lord shall praise him. Completely different from those opening verses. But in order to get to that second section, we've had to go through the trial and the tribulation and the misery and the sorrow. And I suppose the lesson that we can learn from that is to learn that faithfulness is difficult. Faithfulness is challenging, and leadership is difficult and hard and taxing. We heard in the Old Testament reading the reasonably familiar story of the call to Abraham to offer his precious son, Isaac, as a sacrifice. Abraham has been called and told that he's going to be a source of blessing. But my goodness me, what a test was put before him. Yet, we are told Abraham was faithful. He did as he was commanded, trusting that, well, not all would be well, but trusting that somehow his faithfulness would be rewarded in some way. We think of Moses being called to lead the people of God out of exile. He was uncertain. He was one, we were told, who was slow of speech. And so he had, as it were, a second in command. But there was no doubt about it. He was called, and he was told, and he eventually accepted, and he pressed on faithfully. Faithfulness for him was hard, as it was for Abraham. Leadership was hard, as it was for Abraham. But again, Jeremiah? Well, Jeremiah tried to wriggle out of the call. I'm too young, I won't know what to say. They won't believe someone as young as me if they send me to the people. My words will be on your lips. Go to the people and say to them whatever I tell you to say. And on we go. The message that Jeremiah had to deliver was an uncomfortable, disturbing message that led to him getting into all sorts of difficulties. But again, faithful leadership in difficult situations. And the third I mentioned, Ezekiel, with the people who have failed, with the people who are in exile, presenting to them, the people who had failed, a better vision of what could be. The dry bones would come back to life. So today, Abraham, who was called to be a blessing, but who was significantly challenged. Then we move on to our reading from the Acts of the Apostles. By now, Pentecost has happened. By now, the apostles are being sent out into all sorts of different places. And we have this interesting encounter between Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. Back in the context of those days, there were all sorts of religious practices around, all sorts of gods from whom you could pick and choose. And the Ethiopian eunuch, his role was the equivalent of Rishi Sunak, actually, Chancellor of the Exchequer, the Queen of the Ethiopian nations. He's there in the chariot and he's reading the prophet Isaiah. We might interpret the Ethiopian eunuch as a searcher. He wasn't necessarily convinced that the Jews had the answer to his religious quest, but he's there reading from the prophet Isaiah. And Philip is somehow called and sent to him. And so he explains how that prophecy about the suffering servant was fulfilled in Christ. And it seems that the Ethiopian eunuch made his choice and becomes a follower. Abraham grafted into the body of the Lord, answering the call. Philip, like all the other apostles who faced such terrible persecution in those days, still faithful and grafted into the Lord. And both of them, in their different ways, bearing fruit. Which brings us to the gospel passage for today. The last of the I am sayings from the gospel according to St. John. Again, understand the context. We're in the upper room on the night before Christ dies. And in what John records is crystallized some of Christ's best teaching. You must abide in me. It's one of John's favorite words in that translation four. But I want to suggest to you that what John is saying is, you must be grafted into me. You mustn't be loosely connected with me, but you must be embedded in everything that I have to say and everything that I have to teach. And as it was for those people in that upper room, so the same is the call to you and to me. By this my Father is glorified. By this my Father's kingdom is advanced, if only by a tiny, tiny bit. That you as individuals and you as a collective abide in me, are grafted into me, are cleansed and joined to me. Because actually, says John, or John's Jesus, apart from me, you won't succeed. Apart from me, you won't have the vision. If in terms of the church, in terms of your religious practice, you simply seek to maintain